once again for the third time. A warm good afternoon to one and all present here. So the good thing about coming after such a stalwart speaker, Dr. Shailesh Kumar, is he has already given a lot of insights on data and mobility. So he had made my job a lot easier. So as soon as I saw that my presentation is just before the lunch, I was like, okay, I don't want to bother too much. I mean, like, I don't want grumpy faces sitting close to me at lunch. So I'll keep it as short as possible. So, just a second. Yeah. So I'll touch upon the future of mobility and its data products. So as you all know, Siemens does well in so many areas. I mean, like, we have Siemens refrigerators, Siemens washing machines, dishwashers, and we also do very well in healthineers. I mean, like, we have a separate division called healthineers. We do a lot of medical devices, state-of-the-art facilities at Siemens. So my part is with Siemens Mobility. Mobility in terms of with respect to trains and rail transport. So I'd like to share some of the data products that we build and how it helps our ecosystem. So here you go. Data is massive, isn't it? So I'm going to talk about that first, and then I'll share some of the strategies that the industries follow, and particularly what Siemens follow. And then I'll touch upon the Siemens Mobility and its products. So I'll share a sneak preview into our platform, and I'll touch upon some of the data products that we build in our ecosystem. So as you all know, I mean, like, Dr. Shailesh Kumar was speaking a lot about connected apps, smart cities, and a lot of applications that are giving us a lot of data. So data is massive. I mean, like, a couple of decades back, there was just business data. I mean, like, what are things that were sold and what are the things that goes in and goes out was mere data. But nowadays, in this current trend, machine data and human data are humongous. I mean, like, everybody is talking about data. So you have been hearing a lot of talks for the past couple of days about data, data, and data. So such is the amount of data. So we have a lot of scope. I mean, like, everybody is using this digital disruption and making a lot of data products. So you can see tons and tons of beautiful data products in almost every single field right now. A shocker of a fact. So 2020 is now. I mean, like, just 20 years back, almost half of the Fortune 500 companies were pushed outside just because of the digital disruption. So I'd like to point to a couple of examples that everybody can relate here. So you all know Kodak camera, right? Kodak. So they almost went bankrupt around 2012-13. Where they failed? I mean, like, they were producing good cameras, high quality cameras, and they were pushing the market up to its pace. But where they failed, in my opinion, is they failed to realize that people share the pictures online as well. So they weren't as, I mean, like, they weren't up to the pace as Facebook. I mean, even before Mark Zuckerberg wrote a single code of Facebook, they were, like, on top. But see now, I mean, like, Kodak is still struggling. I mean, like, they went bankrupt in 2012, and they are still declining phase as well. And I can also give you another example where Fast Track Car Agency, I mean, like, they were doing really good. Since I come from Chennai, I mean, like, I could see Fast Track doing really well around 2009-10. But look at where they are now. So the foreign investors like Ola, Uber took over the market. They failed to again capitalize on the amount of data they had. So they had a lot of data already. I mean, the number of customers, the bookings, and the journeys, and the prices as well. But they failed to make a model out of it. So that is where people need to look at. I mean, like, there are chances and there are places where you can make use of your own data. I mean, you don't have to look at the data outside of the world. I mean, if you can look inside, there will be a lot of data which you can make use of. You can build a model, you can build an app, you can build some beautiful data product that could be a massive hit in the future. So that is my point. I mean, like, people failing to realize that the data and the disruptive nature of the technology has falling behind the pace of the market. So what is the strategy like companies not only in Germany but in India, they do follow? In my opinion, they are trying to develop the right thing. So developing the right thing, what does it mean? I mean, it as again Shailesh said, it's not about building the model, it is about connecting the models. So you should develop the right thing, and at the same time you should make use of the right data. What do you mean by right data then? I mean, data is humongous, as we discussed. So data is everywhere. So we need to look at what particular data we need to dig deeper and to build a model. So it's not about digging all the data and trying out several things. It's about developing the right thing. So to develop a right thing, we have two constraints. One is budget, and the other one is time. So we need to be cautious about these two factors as well. Because in this growing pace, everybody is trying to bring out a data product. And the thing is, we need to understand the methods, so the methodologies. So before I was with Telefonica, O2. So there, in Germany, most of the people use postpaid network. I mean, rather than using prepaid, we use postpaid. So what we did is, we were trying to guess when the customer would go for a second SIM card. So the customers, Telefonica is actually a telecommunications company. So what we did is, we were trying to guess when the customer would go for the next SIM card. So we were trying to find out what are the attributes that can actually make a customer go for the next SIM card. So be it his age, his marital status, for instance, his relocation because of his job or a marriage. So these are the factors that we were trying to guess. So we were initially digging into decision trees and then later on trying to build a random forest model as well. So nowadays, we would like to make it repeatable. So at Siemens, what we do is we have a term called fables. So what we try to do is to make repeatable modules. So we don't build everything from the scratch. So we build models and we keep it as separate chunks, small chunks, one after the other. So we build a network and then somebody who jumps in doesn't have to, start from the scratch. So we have repeatable modules that anybody can make use of. And we are also in a phase of selling those modules. I mean, like, I'll talk about the particular platform, Railigent, that we own. So it's not about having applications in-house and on our platforms. We are also now trying to sell the modules as well. So that is the interesting thing up next. So there is a saying, big data costs money, because you need to, store somewhere, right? You need to store all these big data. But at the same point, big analytics, it earns money. So building a lot of data products, building dashboards, and beautiful visualizations, it earns money. So data science makes your systems smarter, but at the same time, decision science, it makes you smarter. So this is where the industry is heading on right now. So they want people to take more decisions, so rather than just being data scientists, where one is so good at technology, statistics, math, one needs to also involve himself or herself in building a proper communication between the clients and the customers. So one needs to dig deeper and sit with the customers upfront just to know the requirements so that you will be able to build a lot of data products. So it has to be ad hoc as well as post hoc. So if you build a data product, it doesn't mean that it ends there. So it is all about the continuous process. So as I said, having a business idea, math, and technology basics doesn't mean that you are a really good data scientist. So you need to have a decision thinking, clear decision thinking, where each and every one of us should take responsibility. So that is where you'll be a standalone. I mean, in a pool of data scientists or a data engineers, you need to be, you need to take clear decisions. So that is one thing. And the amount of behavioral sciences that you have learned in schools and colleges, and that you have shaped up past historical data products in your career, this helps you to be a more clear decision maker as well. So as I said, it is about question driven. So you should ask a lot of questions. So the moment you sit with the clients and the customers, you should be interacting. It is not about just metric driven. So it is about asking a lot of questions. What shall we do? What shall I do? What if I build this model? What if it goes wrong? So you should be more interactive. And as I said, it should be ad hoc and post hoc. So it should be spontaneous. I mean, like, there could be a data product spontaneously right at the moment, at this very moment. So you can think about a data which you can think about a data product as well out of it. So you should be very attentive, particularly in this mobility domain. So the focus should be more on speed and the flexibility. And as I said, the output should be embedded into a report or a dashboard or a scoring engine, which is more interactive. So I have seen a lot of SAP interactive dashboards, which are very beautiful. So building a dashboard with Tableau, be it Spotfire or SAP, you need to be creative. So the way you convince people with your data product is more important and critical. So what are Siemens Mobility? What are they doing? So we have a Railigent platform where we have our own data transmission. So we have a MCOM box. So what we do is we carry that box, we go and fit it to trains. Trains in the sense, we do business across the globe. So we also had a partnership with Indian Railways at the moment. We work for metros across the globe. So we work for Netherlands Metro, Metro Prague, for instance, in Czech Republic, our own German metro systems and suburban trains. So what we do is we collect data, we store it, and our platform, Railigent, means rail plus intelligent. So we have our own ecosystem where we build ecosystems, where we build data visualizations and data products. So we have a pool of data scientists, data engineers, and data visualization experts who crunch data and bring value and insights into the data products. So what could be the possible outcome? I mean, like, we have our ecosystems, we build products and we publish it. And then we give access to to the requested people or the clients. So it can be on all the levels, be it management, dispatcher or the maintenance engineers, SSL layman, everybody will be given rights to such ecosystems where they can access their applications. I mean, it's not about accessing all the applications. So if a customer is from Den Haag, which is from Netherlands, they'll get an access to their particular application. I mean, like, we have a set of applications which is quite open to everybody, but it doesn't mean that everybody can access all the applications. And as the small portion on the left and right hand side is in German, it is already readable. I mean, it is modular, it is scalable, and at the same time, it is also open. So I'll walk through some of the examples that what we are doing. So this is just a sneak preview of our platform, our ecosystems. So the one at the top here is Metro Prague. You can see here that the Metro Prague accelerator. So what we do is an accelerator program which runs for 6 weeks. So everybody is running behind data, and we are running short of time as well. So we do a 6-week run through where we get the data from the customers, and we give them a sneak preview about what we could do out of the data. So we get some historical data or live data from a chunk of period. So let's say starting from January to June or June to December, we get those data from them, we crunch it, we build data products, and we give it to them onto our ecosystem. We give the access to them. So as you can see there, we have separate login systems. So this is a project of Metro Prague. So what we did here is maintenance schedules. So right now, the railway maintenance are more or less fixed. So right now, they are investing a lot of time and money into doing some maintenance on mobility products. But what we have suggested is an interactive and a maintenance schedule that is more promptive. So let's say which doors are used most, which compressors in the trains have been used most. So by doing so, we get a data from those maintenance sheets where we could look on which particular train components have been used a lot or which components have been less used. So that saves us a lot of time, energy and money as well while doing those maintenance schedules. And one such another example is infrastructure cases. So the project Copano is from South Africa, where we deal with trains carrying a lot of ore materials like iron ores and magnesium ores across a line of 200 kilometers or more. So what we do is we separate those 200 kilometers into chunks. So line A, B, C and so on. So it needs to be offloaded at a place which is, as I said, 200 to 300 kilometers wide. So we need to find where the trains get locked. Like in some cases there will be bidirectional lines, in some cases there will be unidirectional lines. So one needs to be sure that each trains are passing each networks within the allotted time. So there will be an estimated time that the train crosses bubble A to B around 8 hours, let's say 8 hours. Then it needs to follow that routine, right? So there shouldn't be a bottleneck where trains get locked or a driver gets off the train, or because it's such a huge network of few hundred kilometers. So we should be taking care of those infrastructure cases as well. And then, as I said, train delay prediction is one another beautiful case. So now we have metros in the place where I come from. We have Chennai Metro, Hyderabad Metro. But we are doing this case for London Metro. So in London, a metro runs once in every 2 minutes. So even as a delay of, let's say, 10 seconds or 20 seconds can disrupt the entire network. So what we do is we find out the door opening and closing patterns. We just see what causes the delay or which factors that causes the delay, and we alert the stations or the infrastructure team accordingly. So we do such cases as well. And then, as I said, rail component failure prediction is like analyzing the components, like say fans, which fans are operated highly, which fans are less used, doors for instance. In most of the cases, doors at the extreme ends will be used a lot. But there are also cases where some of the doors went unoperated. So this will help in the maintenance schedule, scheduling the maintenance. And then ecoCruise status. So like we have as an ecoCruise in our cars, what we have is an ecoCruise model in the trains as well. So what it does is we can find out the energy efficiency of such trains. So we can calculate the driver behavior, for instance, how fast he is driving the trains or how slow he is in operating the trains. We can also have a look at the comparison between the ecoCruise model and the non-ecoCruise models. So these are kind of projects or the visualization of the data products that we build in our ecosystems. So we do it globally. So it's like we have a MCOM box which can be fit into n number of trains. I mean, like we worked with trains starting from 1950s, 60s to the present day trains. So the problem with working with older trains is the data. I mean, the data isn't that beautiful, so we need to work a lot with it. So we need to do a lot of data cleaning before we get into the business. So my point here is, it's not just about building a data visualization or a data product. So it's about taking the ownership to each and every product. So try to, I mean, some of the projects that that are stated here, they just come out of a business talk at a coffee place or even at a lunch. So such should be the spontaneity of your attentiveness in the business. So one needs to be attentive, particularly in a domain like mobility. We are really proud to have data products that are under operation at the moment. So some people, they have built beautiful models, but what is the end results? Most of the data products that have been built are not under production. So in comparing to such cases, we are really proud that we build a lot of cool data products which are in operation at the moment. So thinking, logical thinking is more important, and decision making, as I said, has to be prompt so that you build better decision data products. And the thing is, as soon as we have a clear-cut result of the accelerator program, we now know that the customers will go for a bigger deal. So after some point, after the six-week accelerator program, we now know what is the end result or what could be the possible result. So then they go for a bigger deal. They sign up with us for a bigger deal where we work on a broader project, where we work for a year-long or a two-year project in this particular domain. So I would like, yeah. So that's it. So I'll just do a quick recap. So we have a lot of data, so we need to be more prompt and attentive in trying to bring out valuable data products, and then the strategies that the companies use nowadays. And then we also saw some of the Railigent applications, so the intelligent rail applications that Siemens has built. And with this, I would like to end my talk with 2 points. One is, this is offline of the talk. One is respect women, and the next thing is save the planet, because we don't have planet B. Thank you.